Okay, now let us talk about k-means clustering algorithm, which is the oldest clustering algorithm, the father of all clustering algorithms. It was really introduced at the very beginning of the age, which we call the artificial intelligence age, where all these basic notions of machine learning that we use today were formulated. So first, let's say, principles of k-means go back to 1956, and it was more or less explicitly formulated in 1957. So, but before talking about k-means, let's talk about one notion that we will need to understand how it works is the notion of Voronoi cell. So Voronoi cell is a decomposition of a space, it can be two-dimensional or n-dimensional space in the regions, such that the points in each particular region are closest to the particular selected point. For example, if you have two points in two-dimensional space, one and two. So if we plot the line between these two points and find the middle of this line and then plot a perpendicular to this line, then any point in this part of the space will be closer to one than to two. Okay, and any point in this part of the space will be closer to point two than to point one. This is easy to understand. You can do the same in three-dimensional space, but in this case, instead of a line, you will have to plot a plane, two-dimensional plane. And if you do it in n-dimensional space, then this will be n minus one-dimensional hyperplane, which would separate two regions of the space in two parts. So okay, so this is simple. Imagine that we have three points, one, two, three. And again, we would like to split our space into three regions such that the points in each particular region would be closer to a particular, let's say, center of this region. So, and now you have several, actually segments, open segments of a line. So which all converge in one point, and you have now this kind of shape of a region of a data space with a property that each point in this region is closer to one than to two or to three points. Okay, and each point here is closer to three than to one and to two, and you can do it for arbitrary number of a finite number of kind of points. For example, in this case you have seven points. And the corresponding Voronoi cells would look like this in two-dimensional plane. And you can see that some Voronoi cells are open to infinity, but some Voronoi cells became kind of closed cells. So any point here is closer to this point than to any other point. Okay, so and this is an example of Voronoi decomposition of two-dimensional square with something like 100 points, and you can see that you might have more or less a complex shapes of these Voronoi cells, but they all have a particular property that all of them are convex shapes. So you cannot have a shape which would be concave. Okay, now when we understand what does it mean Voronoi cell, we can already start formulating. Let us see how k-means algorithm works. Just formulate the steps of the algorithm and let us see how it will, for example, cluster this particular configuration of points, which looks quite simple, and it's quite evident that we have five relatively well-defined clusters. So the first step of the algorithm, we arbitrarily put five points at random locations, and we will call them candidate cluster centers. but they don't have to correspond to the cluster structure. I mean, we don't know this cluster structure at all. We just put these data points somewhere, and it's not unclever to put these points into existing points of the data. So you can just select five random points of the data and define them as candidate centers of future clusters. Then what you do, you decompose your data space into Voronoi cells, like I showed you before. So now, I mean, for each point, you define the corresponding Voronoi cell, okay? And then what you do, that for each Voronoi cell, for all points contained in this Voronoi cell, you compute the mean value. You compute the point, which is a mean conditional on this Voronoi cell. So for example, this green point will be a mean point of all points in this Voronoi cell and correspondingly. And then you move your initial candidates of clusters into this new center. Okay, and as a matter of fact, that's it. You just need to repeat it with the new positions of candidate clusters. And when you will do it, in this illustration, do not pay attention to these rectangles. I mean, they're supposed to explain different things. But pay attention to these centers of clusters, which are colored here in different colors. And by the colors of data points, they also put in different colors, you see which points in your data set belongs to the Voronoi cell defined for this particular center. And you can see how your cluster centers start to move. Okay. So, and in the end, they converge to a certain configuration. And you can see that the final position of these points, so they don't move anymore, they correspond to the clusters, and the data points in your data set are colored accordingly to the proximity to these cluster centers. And you can see that these colors perfectly correspond to what we would call clusters in this data set. Okay? So let us look once again how it works. It's our original configuration of points, and then the jump. Just pay attention that the blue point relatively quickly found the position of the blue cluster, but look at this red point. How? So it moves first in this direction, but then it moves here in this region in the space, and then stop. Okay. Okay, so in principle, that's it. I mean, you don't have to know much more to explain how the k-mean algorithm works. But there are questions, and actually these are general questions that you have to ask when you invent a new clustering algorithm, or more generally optimization algorithm, you should ask this question. So first question is, so we introduced an algorithm, but and we kind of start from some initial configuration of points and we end up with some final configuration of points. But the question is, do we optimize anything, and what we optimize in this process? So is there any function that we try to optimize by this sequence of steps? Second question is, are we sure that it will converge, it will terminate, or these points might, there are some cases where these points might maybe they stop for some time, but when you apply afterwards some other iterations, they might start traveling all around the data space. Next question, are we sure that we find an optimal clustering among all possible clusters? So they will converge to some initial configurations. Let's imagine that they converge, then we can prove it. But then the question is, will it be a global optimum of something that we try to optimize, or it will be only local optimum, and it is possible to have other local optimum. And then some kind of related questions is, how should we start the algorithm, how we should choose the position, the initial position of points, and how could we automatically choose the number of clusters? So this question we will discuss a little bit later in a separate part of the lecture, where we'll talk about this for all clustering algorithms at the same time. because there is no solution which would be very specific to k-means clustering algorithms. There are solutions which work in for certain families of clustering algorithms, including k-means, for example. So let us answer these questions one by one. First, what is it trying to optimize? And the answer to this question is known. Just let us give it from the very beginning. Is the k-means algorithm optimizes the sum of squared distances to the closest from any data point to the closest centroid. So you already saw this picture, and this picture can be called one mean. Actually, if you will take for k-mean clustering only one cluster, then we will converge to the point which will be the mean point. And actually, you will converge in one iteration. It's very easy to understand. And we already saw, I mean, when we discussed what does it mean, the mean point, we already saw that we can define the mean point as such a point that minimizes the sum of squared distances between this point and all other points. Okay, then k-means is actually the simple generalization of this notion of a mean. This is why it's called k-means, because each cluster is a local mean point for the cluster that it defines. So for example, the case of two mean, two clusters, so then your data points are split into two groups, and within each group, the position of this cluster cluster center minimizes the sum of squared distances from the points in this cluster to the centroid of the cluster. Okay, so really what you try to minimize is the sum of squared distances of these red lines. Okay, let's another important remark that these points that we try to find, the position of clusters that we try to find in k-means algorithm, can be called principal points. And we will talk about the definition of, let's say, self-consistency a little bit later, because we will need this definition for defining what we will call principal curves or more complicated objects approximating the data. So it's so this notion of self-consistency is one of the most fundamental in unsupervised machine learning. But here, this self-consistency is quite simple. It just states that the position of each center of the cluster is a conditional mean of the points in the cluster. And the conditioning means that we condition our mean on the fact that the points in this cluster have, among all possible centroids, have this centroid as the closest one. So we somehow project a data point onto the closest centroid, and conditioned on this projection, the cluster center is the mean point of the cluster points. Also, just let us talk about this optimality. So I gave some kind of hand-waving description of what k-means tries to optimize, but let us look a little bit in more details using the language of encoding and decoding. And actually, this is important to talk about this language, because sometimes it's claimed, and I think it corresponds to reality, that k-means is not paradoxical. It's not a clustering algorithm. What it tries to find are not clusters. It tries to find optimal encoding of the data. This is why initially the k-means algorithm was introduced as data encoder. It's a way to simplify the data with a minimal distortion of the encoding. So to talk in this language is useful also because this idea of encoding and decoding can be easily generalized for application of neural networks. So in neural networks, you quite naturally you can define decoding and encoding layers, a set of layers, and then you can define a deep learning based, for example, clustering methods which exist in the field. But let us define what does it mean encoder function. Encoder function is simply a function which takes a point from your multidimensional data space and give one integer number from 1 to k, where k is a number of clusters. So it maps each point to a number which signifies the number of the cluster. And decoding function, you take an integer number from 1 to k, and then you produce a point in multidimensional space. So encoding, decoding. And of course, when you encode, you reduce the complexity enormously. So instead of a complete data table, which might contain millions and millions of entries, in the end, you have only k integer numbers. And I mean, so this is a drastic and a huge reduction of complexity. But of course, this encoding and decoding should be chosen in such a way that you would minimize some distortion. And the typical way to define the distortion function is you say that you are going to minimize the sum of squared distance, squared deviations from encoding and then decoding back as a data point, and then you sum up over all data points in your data set. So this distortion is a function that you try to minimize. So in geometrical sense, this perfectly corresponds to what I've just described. So what you try to minimize is the sum of squared lengths of these red line segments. So actually, I mean, for notations, this decode G, so mapping from an integer number back into multidimensional space, we can denote it as CJ. And then simply, I mean, this distortion is corresponds to what was written here, is a sum of squared distances between a data point, and then this C for the G, which is encoded from this data point. So this is what you try to minimize. It's a matter of rewriting for the moment. But this rewriting might help us to understand certain things. So the first question that we can ask, what properties must these centers C1, C2, CK, because these are vectors in multidimensional space, what properties they must have when the distortion is minimal? And the answer to this is simple, that the Xi must be encoded by the nearest center. So which simply means that when we project our data point Xi into one of these centers, you should always select the closest center. So why? It's simply to explain why. Because if you would connect this point to the center which is not closest, C1 in this case, then the length of this red line would be bigger than the length of this line. And then if you would simply reconnect this point from C1 to C2, then the corresponding sum will become smaller. And this is a proof that if we will encode a data point by the closest center, centroid, so C2 in this case, then it will give the optimal encoding, which will produce a minimal distortion. Then the second question is, so now let us understand what should be the center of this data, C1, C1, C2, CK. It's another requirement is what these numbers should, what conditions they should satisfy to give minimal distortion. And here we do a computation that we already did in the previous lecture, that we compute what is the position of this C encode corresponding to the encoding of vector xi which would give the minimal value of the distortion. And this is a simple minimization of quadratic form, non-negative, non-negatively defined. And we did this exercise in the previous lecture, computing that the position of CI is the local center of the data. So it's a mean point for all points owned by CG. Okay. So this is the same computation that we did for defining the mean point, just we generalize this computation for the case where we have several mean points. And as a matter of fact, this allows us to say that if every vector xi is encoded into the closest center, and if each center is a centroid, which means mean point of the points that it owns, if these two conditions are satisfied, then our distortion has a local minimum. We cannot guarantee that it will be global minimum, but for local minimum we can guarantee. And as a matter of fact, this is what k-means does. So k-means, what it does is just sequentially it tries to optimize either first or second condition, and then iterate over that. And in each step of this optimization, the distortion can only decrease. So the first remark is that from this consideration, it's already clear that we must terminate in in state, which would never change neither one or two condition. Why? The answer is simple, because the total number of splits of the data points by the closest centroids is finite. So whatever number of steps we would make, at some point we will pass by all possible configurations. And since at each point we only minimize the distortion, so the total number of steps of the algorithm will be finite. So this is a proof why a k-means converges. Of course, this number of steps might be too big for any reasonable applications. Usually k-means algorithm converges, in simple situations, quite fast. But sometimes, and indeed, it can converge to the final state when nothing will change quite slowly. In this case, we have to apply some additional stopping criteria, which would say that, okay, we are satisfied with this configuration. We are not going to improve it anymore, because all other improvements will be just infinitesimal. They will be too small to be noticed in any for any practical reasons. Okay. So the question, do we find the optimal configuration? As I already told you, not necessarily, because we can be trapped in a local minimum. And this is a feature of most of the clustering algorithms. It's very difficult to find the global optimum of the criteria that you optimize. Just to illustrate this point, let us take this simple definition, this simple clustering of points. In this case, we have three clusters. And if imagine that we guessed wrongly the number of clusters. So instead of taking k equals 3, we take k equals 3. You might find, for example, if you start from this configuration of k, it won't change anymore. So this will correspond to the local minimum of the distortion. But in this configuration, these two clusters would split this cluster in two, and this cluster would combine these two clouds of data points. And believe me, this corresponds to the local minimum of the distortion. But this is far from being optimal. The optimal one will be when each centroid will be the center of each of these groups of points. But you might be trapped in this particular configuration. So which means that you should be careful where you start your algorithm. It's vague advice. The more concrete advice that when you apply k-means algorithm, that you should start from many initial starts, and then choose the one which will give you the minimum distortion of your encoding decoding. But there are many other algorithms how to do it better. So for example, a simple trick might be put points one by one. So you can start with a randomly chosen data point, but the second point you can already put in such a data point which will be as far as possible from the first data point, and then you can continue putting the data the centers following these heuristics. So this already might give you a good heuristics for choosing the starting configuration of centers. Okay, so where K-mean algorithm is used? It's written here that it's often used as a part of exploratory data analysis. I must say that in practical situations, there are certain limitations of K-means clustering algorithms, that it's less and less used as a kind of principal clustering principal clustering methods which would deliver the clusters. In many situations, it might be used for complexity reduction. It might be used, for example, to coarse grain big data. This is quite convenient because, as I have told you, K-means, as a matter of fact, it's an algorithm which gives you optimal encoding of the data, or in other words, compression of the data. So using K-means with sufficiently large number of K, for example, few hundreds, you can compress the complexity of really large data set from millions of points to few hundreds of data points just by pre-clustering, because the algorithm is very fast. There are some specific applications of K-means clustering algorithm. For example, in one dimension, it's a good way to quantize variables into buckets, into some kind of group of points. But in principle, it's exactly what I have told you for the case of big data. It's just not big difference between one-dimensional case and n-dimensional case. As I have told you already, it's a fast algorithm. So if we pay attention to the power for the number of points in this expression, it's exactly one, which means that the algorithm is fast when, of course, when the number of clusters is not too big. But usually the number of clusters that you choose is much smaller than the number of data points. So this is why the K-means algorithm remains fast. The disadvantage is that it terminates in local optimum, which is, by the way, common for many clustering algorithms. The more bigger limitation is to apply K-means algorithm. We need to be able to compute the mean value, and we can compute the mean value first only if you have the initial data table, so complete data table. So we cannot work directly with the distance matrix, for example, or with KNN graph in case of KNN. And of course, I mean, we have to think how to encode and quantify categorical data, for example. Of course, we need to specify the number of clusters, but again, I mean, that's for all algorithms, you have to do it in one way or another. And K-means by itself is very sensitive to noisy data sets, unfortunately. This is why application to real-life data sets for clustering is limited. There are simple ways to improve this sensitivity to noise. And one of the improvement, which is already, for example, in my field in bioinformatics, it's quite widely used. It's called PAM. Which means partitioning around midoids. It's a simple generalization of the K-mean algorithm when instead of computing the mean value as the most representative value for a cluster, you take a midoid. And in this case, the definition of midoid is such an object in your cluster, such a point in your cluster, which minimize the sum of absolute deviations from the sum of the distances, not square distances, but sum of the distances from this point to all other points. So this is the definition of midoid in this case. And it's known that midoids, which are tightly connected to these properties of L1 metrics that we have discussed in the previous lecture, It is known that they are much less sensitive to the presence of outliers. So this is a simple illustration of this in 1D. So if you have a compact group of points here, for example, and when you have an outlier, then the mean will be shifted towards this outlier, and it might end up completely out of the of this distribution of points, while midoid will be much less sensitive to the presence of outliers. Okay, so it looks like a good solution of the situation when you have noisy data, but there are certain disadvantages of this solution. For example, and one of the biggest disadvantages that this PAM algorithm is way more computationally expensive than a k-means algorithm. So you don't have this n power one scaling of the algorithm anymore. It's rather close to n square, which makes it practically, so this is shown here, so practically unusable for realistic size real life data sets. And so, as I have told you, k-means is the father of all clustering methods, and many more sophisticated clustering algorithms are built on top of the idea of k-means. So, for example, you can, instead of taking a centroid as just a single point, you can take as a centroid as a line segment. And then in this case, you can call it K lines clustering or K segments clustering. And an example of such clustering is shown here. So the advantage of this algorithm that is it allows to deal with these elongated shapes of the clustering, so it can take into account the possible heterogeneity, linear heterogeneity within each cluster. So there are multiple ideas how to make k-means soft clustering, kind of relaxing these requirements that each point in the data set should be attributed to only particular, to only one cluster. So in this fuzzy version of k-means clustering, each point can belong to more than one cluster. And also there are different ideas how to deal with noise in the data, so very strong outliers. So for example, there is a version of k-means with trimming, when in each particular iteration, the points which are too distant from any centroid, they do not contribute to the definition of the new centroid position. They are just ignored. They might be taken to account at the next iteration, but this is what you do at each particular iteration. You kind of filter out those data points which are too far from the current position of the centroids. So I guess, I think we can stop here discussing k-means, and in the next part of the lecture, we will go to the hierarchical clustering algorithms. But on the last slide, if you like to play with k-means, which I think is important to play a little bit with k-means to understand how it works and what are the possible traps you can have in application of k-means, there is a nice tutorial at Real Python resource. So I advise you to have a look at it. Okay.